Tonight on KPBS Evening Edition, high-density housing in North County. Escondido considers a plan to redevelop an old hospital into hundreds of new homes. And pro-choice supporters hold a rally in San Diego as people across the country protest new laws that would restrict abortion access.
Like, you know, the branches of the branching out of your lungs, the same thing applies to animals that might have several different pathways for their reproductive system.
See how engineers at UC San Diego are using robotics to help save endangered rhinos.
We want to inspire a love of learning, and nothing can snuff that out faster than having an anxious moment with a parent.
And the STEM summer camp designed for parents. KPBS Evening Edition starts right now. Good evening. It's Tuesday, May 21st. Thanks for joining us. I'm Ebony Monet. A new task force will help San Diego and cities across the state deal with homelessness. Governor Gavin Newsom announced the task force today in Oakland. The latest point in time count for the Bay Area shows a 43% rise in homelessness over the past 2 years. The task force will try to develop individual plans that meet the needs of local communities. One local community trying to build more housing is Escondido. KPBS North County reporter Allison St. John says a plan to knock down the old Palomar Hospital building would redefine the downtown area.
The old Palomar Hospital sits on 13 acres of prime real estate in the center of downtown Escondido. It overlooks Grand Avenue, the city's business district. It is slated to be shut down because a new Palomar Hospital opened elsewhere in Escondido in 2012. This week, the city held the first workshop to invite public comment on plans to build more than 500 new homes on the site of the old hospital.
So this is the proposed site plan, kind of conceptual for Palomar Heights. Some senior apartments here, some are also larger multifamily residential apartments here. And these would be ownership units, they're townhomes and villas.
The plans call for 3- and 4-story housing. Feinstone says city planners wish it could have added even more homes because the city's in such need of more housing units.
And the higher the number, the better for us. Getting 510 units on a site that allows up to 1350, a little bit more than that even, that's going to be a challenge in order to meet our housing goals.
Feinstone says the city recently agreed to allow higher density housing to be zoned more flexibly around Escondido. Feinstone says now is the time for local residents to give their input on the plan for Palomar Heights.
If there's a need for the housing, I mean, if it can be documented that there's that kind of a need for housing and it can support this, then I don't have any real problem with building it. The only real issue is, again, transportation. How do these people get from their units to wherever they're going to work? And if they all got to go out to Interstate 15, that could be a real issue that the city needs to consider prior to approving this project.
Escondido Mayor Paul McNamara says he's in favor of building densely in the city center in order to avoid sprawling out into the countryside surrounding the city.
And so I think this is right now one of the better compromises. This is to infill for the urban core as we try to hold on to our green spaces for future generations.
Allison St. John, KPBS News.
The plan to redesign Horton Plaza has the full support of the San Diego City Council. The council voted unanimously last night to approve the proposal by the property's new owner. An LA-based investment firm bought Horton Plaza last year. The downtown mall will be turned into office space for tech companies. Some retail space will remain. Work on the redevelopment will begin later this year. Local law enforcement will get more training on how to respond to people with mental health challenges. KPBS reporter Matt Hoffman says this plan comes after a year of research.
A study by the district attorney's office found over the past 25 years, 80% of officer-involved shootings included people who had drug or mental health issues. Last year, there were more than 53,000 calls for service involving mental health. District Attorney Summer Steffen says training officers on how to better handle these situations balances public safety with compassion and understanding.
The goal is one that I think our community can truly embrace, a reduced need to use deadly force, improved officer safety, and a reduced likelihood of injury to those in crisis and the public.
The county has special teams designed to handle people in mental health crisis, but Stefan says more can be done. All of the law enforcement agencies in the county will receive this new mental health training starting in the summer. It involves simulations of scenarios with people who are in a crisis, and it's not just officers who will be getting the training, but also police dispatchers. The initiative is being coordinated and funded by the District Attorney's Office. Matt Hoffman, KPBS News.
It has been a day of a national action day for supporters of abortion rights who believe laws passed in Alabama and other states could lead to more restrictions. KPBS health reporter Susan Murphy shows us the rally held today in San Diego.
Nearly 300 abortion rights supporters are gathered here at the downtown San Diego Federal Courthouse. They feel women's rights are under attack. Protesters packed the courtyard, holding up signs, chanting, and uniting in their message.
Forward, together, not one step back.
The demonstration comes after some conservative states approved legislation that would restrict access to abortions. Poppy Fitch with Women's March San Diego helped organize the Stop the Bans rally. She calls the new laws a coordinated attack on women.
We are willing to band together, that we have a power in numbers, and that people, men, women, all humans across the United States will stand up, fight, and unite around this issue of reproductive rights.
James Bond showed up to offer his support. He's worried about the potential impact on poor communities.
Poor people, people in rural areas, people without privilege and access that maybe don't have some of the resources I have.
Wendy Batterson with San Diego Indivisible says abortion opponents are feeling emboldened by the Trump administration and new conservative justices on the Supreme Court.
The 30% of people that are aligning with Trump, that Trump is playing to the evangelical base to keep those votes. He's in a desperate situation, and he's trying to change the laws to please a minority of the people.
Some hope the new laws lead the Supreme Court to overturn the 1973 Roe v. Wade decision. KPBS reached out to anti-abortion groups and did not receive a response. Susan Murphy, KPBS News.
I will nominate Judge Brett Kavanaugh.
A Supreme Court face-off, 30 years in the making.
You will see a system that has become toxic.
When Bork got taken down, they promised never to forget.
It was raw politics, and it was war.
Mitch McConnell is a tactical genius.
We're not giving a lifetime appointment to this president on the way out the door.
Unprecedented.
Democrats are outraged.
We're living in the era of the McConnell court now.
Frontline, tonight at 10 on KPBS.
California's senior population will more than double over the next 25 years, affecting housing, healthcare, and social services. Currently, one in five seniors lives in poverty.
A lot of seniors suffer in silence because they're ashamed, they're embarrassed.
Hi, I'm Amitha Sharma. Tune in to our California Dream Town Hall special. Grain, California airs tomorrow at noon on KPBS Radio, KPBS TV, and streaming live on kpbs.org.
The San Diego Zoo's efforts to revive the nearly extinct northern white rhino is getting a boost from a UC San Diego robotics lab. KPBS environment reporter Eric Anderson shows us some of the tools that might lead to success.
So this is Victoria.
Barbara Durant points to a southern white rhino at an off-exhibit area at the San Diego Zoo Safari Park.
And you can't tell from the outside that she's pregnant unless you're lucky enough to see the baby kick, which we often can see from the outside. If we're really lucky, we might see it right now. But you really can't tell. She hasn't gained that much girth.
The baby she's carrying is the product of artificial insemination, a process being developed by Durant's team. She wants all six to have a successful insemination. Eventually, the reproductive physiologist wants to do something that's never been done before. She wants to implant a rhino embryo that is brought to term. But Durant says the rhino's birth canal presents a problem.
It's large, for one thing. It's very deep within the abdominal cavity, which makes it difficult to access as well. But it has a number of cartilaginous rings that interlock this way. So there's no clear pathway through the cervix when you want to deposit semen or an embryo into the uterus.
The cervix opens up a bit when the rhino is in heat, allowing Durant to use a long, straight metal catheter for artificial insemination. But that won't work for embryo implantation.
The embryo is going to be growing in vitro or in the lab for about 10 to 12 days. So the cervix of this animal, these recipients, is going to be closed. So the only way we're going to be able to get through that cervix is with something that's not rigid and something that we can steer from outside the animal.
So in my lab, we're developing robotic tools.
That something is being developed about 30 miles away in a robotics lab on the UC San Diego campus. Professor Michael Yip is working on a tool that will help navigate the rhino's cervix and deliver an embryo to the animal's uterine horn.
The idea is that you have a long, flexible device with tendons that run through the end all the way to the handle, and we can pull on those tendons like you would marionette a puppet, but in this case, we're actually deflecting the end of this robotic tool.
Yip is modeling the new tool on endoscopes that can be used to inspect a person's colon or lungs without creating an incision. The rhino version is much smaller. Once the device is inserted into the mouth, the catheter can be maneuvered until it reaches a target location.
Just like, you know, the branches of the branching out of your lungs, the same thing applies to animals that might have several different pathways for their reproductive system, much like the rhino, where they have two different uterine horns, and you're trying to make sure that you're entering the right channel versus the other.
So the idea is that the end will track the same motions as the 3D pen.
Undergraduate student Renal Verghese is helping Yip work out different controllers. The finished product could end up being like a gaming controller, an electronic pen, or a small knob on a handheld device, which seems to be the most promising prototype. Verghese says the camera plays an important role.
And actually lets us bring more accuracy and precision to the control system, with the ultimate goal of making it as intuitive as possible for the user.
The narrow tube on this device is hollow, and the tiny camera is threaded through it. Yip says that allows the team to see the rhino's narrow and twisting cervix as it moves along.
Once you get the device articulated into the right location, past the cervix, into the uterine horns of the rhino, you can actually use that hollow channel to flush through the genetic material.
If successful, the procedure will be groundbreaking because it's never been done on a rhino. Durant says the first attempts will be with southern white rhino embryos conceived in the lab.
It'll be southern white rhino embryos into southern white rhinos. Once we've gotten the efficiency, worked out the kinks, so to speak, with the instrumentation, and we feel confident in our technique, that's when we'll take one of those very precious northern white rhino embryos and put it into one of these southern white rhinos.
Durant says the zoo has cell lines from 12 different northern white rhinos stored in a repository known as the Frozen Zoo. Geneticists are working on the protocols that'll turn the frozen tissue into reproductive cells. If both teams are successful, the project could help bring the northern white rhino back from the edge of extinction. Eric Anderson, KPBS News.
It's the middle of spring, but it feels more like a San Diego winter, with more rain expected, especially in East County. Erin Calandra has tonight's forecast.
We are still under a high wind advisory for the interior parts of San Diego County, Borrego Springs, all the way down through Pine Valley. We are seeing wind gusts up to 70 miles per hour across those mountain slopes and through the deserts, and the gustiest winds are going to be this evening. So if you're traveling, you need to be careful. Not only are we going to see some jerky conditions on the highway, but also visibility issues with blowing and drifting dust from those deserts. So be careful there on those roadways. roadways. As far as precipitation, well, we are still seeing some clouds moving through, a thick marine layer, and also a couple of showers in spots. We had a storm coming in to the north of us, and now that precipitation is slowly pushing south. We're even seeing mountain snow. It is unusual for this time of year. We're under a pretty chilly and pretty damp pattern here all across the West Coast. So for tonight, we're at 58 degrees. A shower is expected later tonight, and that's really going to be the case for the interior parts of the county as well. A couple of showers popping up. Ramona, 51 for the low. Chula Vista at 58. And Mount Laguna, Burr, 37 degrees tonight for that low temperature. This pattern is going to continue tomorrow. We have a big dip in the jet stream. Here it is, and that's leaving us wide open for that cold air to come diving down from the north. We'll see frequent showers off and on in spots, and eventually we're going to rebound. But really this week, keep that umbrella handy because we're going to see some showers off and on for the next couple of days. Tomorrow, Oceanside, some sunshine at 66 degrees. Chula Vista, some showers at 64. And Borrego Springs, sunny at 72. That is below average temperatures. Here's what it looks like late week. Still, the jet stream dipping far to the south, keeping us under this chilly pattern. And expect to see some sunshine with some showers popping up Thursday and again on Sunday. Temperatures hovering in those mid to upper 60s. Inland, we'll see temperatures also in the 60s. We'll see showers Wednesday, Thursday, and again possible on Sunday. And by the weekend, we're in those upper to mid 60s. In the deserts, we're in the 70s, reaching the 80s. Some showers will be around, and that's the case for the mountains, too. We're in the 40s and 50s here. For KPBS News, I'm Erin Calandra. Back to you.
It may be embarrassing to admit, but during a course of a child's early academic career, there may become a point when parents have trouble helping with the homework. At least this is the feedback that instructors at UC San Diego Extension were receiving from parents of students taking part in their summer academic program. So they've developed a one-day summer camp. I'm here now with the program's instructor and also the Assistant Dean of Education and Community Outreach for UC San Diego Extension, Morgan Appel.
Yes, thank you. It's very nice to meet you and very nice to be here. Thank you.
Well, welcome. So tell me about this one-day, no-cost program for parents.
So as you mentioned earlier, for a lot of parents, the prospect of providing support to their kids for science education can prove overwhelming. I know in my own experience when my nieces and nephews come to me with science homework, I'll just look at it and just think, it's not something that I can do. I wasn't a great science student in school either. So the point of what we're doing is trying to re-envision science and science learning so that it's accessible and engaging and providing a framework for supporting parents, supporting kids as they move through their studies.
And talk to me about the Sally Ride program that happens at UC Extension for students.
Sure. The Sally Ride Science Junior Academy is a four-week program. It has a four-week component and a week-long component. It is offered at our satellite campus at the 805 and Governor. And that's a complete science immersion program for kids, different experiences, which gets them completely engaged and involved in science. And what we wanted to be able to do is understand that parents need something similar. What we're not trying to do with this course is cram 12 years of content into a day, but rather provide an understanding of how the brain learns science, how emotions connect to science, to help them build skills like resilience and growth mindset, all of these things in the name of supporting science learning for their kids and enjoying science.
So as an instructor, how important would you say resilience is?
Resilience is fundamental. When we talk about science, we talk about it as adventure. We talk about it as precision. We talk about it as chaos and creativity. But also in science is dogged determination. You won't always succeed on the first go. And it's important to be able to go back and try again and to try again. So building up that skills is not only good for science education, but it's good across the board. It's a metacognitive skill, a skill that translates across learning topics and across the lifespan.
So during this one-day course, what can a parent expect?
A parent can expect a lot. Again, it's not going to be your high school science curriculum relived, but you're going to understand about how the brain learns science, how emotion plays a role, how to provide resources and support, and they'll get a, you know, access to resources and support to encourage science learning. Ideas about participating in informal science experiences, because what we know about science is that it's everywhere. Everywhere and anywhere. It's a lens through which we understand our world. All that's fine. Talking about it is great. And touting the benefits of understanding, you know, the socio-emotional elements of science learning is fine. But they're also going to do science. There is going to be hands-on immersion, so the same kind of thing that their kids are doing, they will also be doing. But we're going to have a backing track in form of instruction saying, when you're doing this, this is how your brain is reacting. This is how you are connecting. This is how you are building bridges. This is where your emotions kick in. So they will really understand the benefits of deep immersion in science. And when they are done, they will also showcase their work along with their kids' work at the end of the day.
So if a parent is interested, can you tell us how they can find out more information?
If a parent is interested, you can go to our website at sallyridescience.ucsd.edu. The course is free and it's guaranteed fun and a deep learning experience for everyone.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'm Judy Woodruff. Tonight on the NewsHour, former White House counsel Don McGahn fails to appear before the U.S. House Judiciary Committee, stoking Democrats' anger. Coming up at 7 after Evening Edition on KPBS.
A new lawsuit is trying to keep California from losing federal money for the high-speed rail project. The Trump administration says it will revoke more than $1 billion. California is also asking a judge to block the federal government from redirecting that money to anything else. The Trump administration claims the state hasn't made enough progress on the high-speed rail project. A San Diego company is working with the U.S. Postal Service to test self-driving trucks. The company is called Too Simple. It will provide a couple of long-haul trucks to travel between distribution centers in Phoenix and Dallas. Too Simple says an engineer and driver will be on board to monitor the trucks. 5 trips will be made over the next couple of weeks. Architects at Harvard are trying to find ways to reduce the amount of energy needed to heat and cool a building. Reporter Christina Quinn from WGBH shows us how they're making progress with a design called House Zero.
On a quiet residential street close to Harvard, this pretty nondescript house is known as House Zero.
Why is it called House Zero?
Well, because there are a lot of zeros, right? One is the building doesn't almost use any energy from heating and cooling, and it's zero carbon. It doesn't have any electrical light during the day.
No lights, no HVAC system, and barely a utility bill. The goal of House Zero is to produce more energy than it consumes, ultimately providing power to the grid. Architect Ali Malkawi of Harvard Center for Green Buildings and Cities says it relies only on fresh air and solar energy, and it's quiet.
It is because we don't have any pumps, nothing is moving. It's very much linked to the outside where windows open and close. It's very gentle.
Right, right? There's no hum, there's no room hum.
Nothing.
There's no machines whirring. It is very quiet, but it's comfortably quiet.
It's amazing because we don't notice this unless we see that we are living in environments such as this, mm-hmm. right? Because most of our environments have these humming noises and
right.
we get accustomed to it.
Windows open automatically if it starts to get a little warm or stuffy. And they're framed by panels that provide shade. When the temperature dips outside, the solar chimney keeps the inside temperate.
But what exactly is a solar chimney?
It's a chimney that allows air to move freely without mechanical systems. It allows air to be drawn from the outside and people to be ventilated without mechanical systems in the lower parts, where you cannot do cross ventilation.
All of this, though, relies on really smart technology. Under the floors and throughout House Zero, there are 5 miles of cables and hundreds of sensors capturing data like airflow, temperature, and CO2 levels. Put on a pair of augmented reality goggles, and you can actually see it.
Now, all the information that we are getting from the house is being pulled into a giant database.
No one actually lives here. House Zero is a lab, one Malkawi uses to teach his students that buildings can be living, breathing things that communicate naturally with their environment.
We're basically demonstrating in this building that just natural ventilation is such an easy thing to do, but can it be controllable? And at the same time, we're saying, okay, now this is good. Can we even go beyond that? Can we scale it up, right, with using very simple technologies?
Bringing ultra-efficient homes anywhere in the world. Christina Quinn, WGBH News.
Now, here's a recap of tonight's top stories. A new task force will help San Diego and cities across the state deal with homelessness. Governor Gavin Newsom announced a new task force today in Oakland. The group will work with cities to develop plans that meet the needs of local communities. Local law enforcement will receive more training on how to respond to people with mental health challenges. The district attorney's office will pay for and coordinate the training, which will include officers and dispatchers. It comes after a year of research on law enforcement and mental health. Supporters of abortion rights held a demonstration today outside the San Diego Federal Courthouse. They oppose laws passed in several states that restrict access to abortion. Other protests were held across the country. KPBS reached out to anti-abortion groups, and they did not respond. You can find tonight's stories on our website, kpbs.org/eveningedition. Thanks for joining us. Have a great night.